Greetings and salutations to all you folks out there. So I don't have the mini map today. Quick explanation, and if anybody has a hand for this, if you've used OBS before, please let me know. I'm trying to consolidate my casting into OBS, but I can't record both screens at the same time because it treats it like one program. So no matter what I do, it only records the minimap screen. I'm having a lot of issues with it, and I would like to move to a set of professional recording software, but I can't afford it at the moment. So if anybody has experience with OBS, I would love it if you would contact me through private message, because I'm beating my head against the wall on this, because these big games, people have been asking for sentence for a long time, and I'm going to give you a sentence today, but it's going to be without the minimap, because I was having some hitching issues the other day, and it's not going away, and the only way I can eliminate the hitching is to set the core affinity with the task manager. And if I use the task manager, it breaks the OBS recording. So I'm kind of caught in a catch-22 here, because I can't use what I need to use to get what I need done. And it's kind of ticking me off, to be honest. So I'm just going to go ahead with this cast. We're going to get through it. And maybe I'll get some feedback from some people or figure something else out before the next cast. Anywho, sentence time. Pro level sentence time. This has got some big names in it. Let's just dive into the teams. I'm assuming this is random factions, random placements, like it normally is in a game like this. Let's just introduce the teams and then we will get on with it. It is fast a pace as we possibly can so that we can get done with this in a reasonable amount of time. On the North Beach, we have Gareth taking UEF. UEF Air for Mr. White. Then we have Foley, the almighty 2400, taking Cybern on the Rock slot. This is going to be the guy to watch over here. The Rock is the power position on Settings. Solar taking Cybern on the front. So we have two UEF, two Cybern, no Aeon. Then UEF Air, a thug for life, TA for life, on the Southern team. Then we've got M&B, the old Settings pro, on the beach slot as Cybern. And then we've got UEF on the front for Philip J. Fry. And Lanalus taking the only Aeon faction pick in the Rock slot for the Southern team. So we have two extremely good players in the Rock slots versus people who... all due respect to M&B, because he was whoop my tail if I put it out there in front of him, but I don't think M&B can match Foley, especially from the Rock position. This is going to lose. This is definitely going to lose. And front is going to play a part in which way this whole thing falls. Overall, we're just going to have to kind of sit back and watch and see what happens. Looks like we have a bunch of early aggression coming northward from that would be Philip J. Fry. He is going to get those mech marines all the way around the outside edge, more than likely push them all the way up towards the Hydro, try to snag those engineers and power stall his front opponent, because if you can power stall someone, you can beat that someone. Looping the mech marine around the backside with the scout that is going to try to pick off this engineer, which is immediately hightailing it for the forward Rex with the ACU, so that this mech marine will have to come in range of the ACU, and there it is. Alright, so we're going to have a little tiny bit of a mass advantage, but not much. That engineer picked up a little tiny bit of mass, and then the ACU popped it off. That second engineer can be very, very powerful. The first engineer out of the factory, second engineering unit out to the front. If you attack move them right here from the factory, they can actually suck up the Salem Rex without ever getting close. And over here on the left, let's see, we've got some bomber play. I'm going to slow this down. Screw it if we go way over our time allotment. Let's enjoy all of this luscious action here at the beginning, because it is inevitably going to turtle up towards the end. We've got three engineers down from Lanalus. It's going to immediately start building a PD. And here comes the bomber. Engineer drop close, trying to get in range, just about bombed out his own. Just about bombed out his own engineers on board that transport. One engineer left. And it looks like things are going decently well for Gareth. That is surprising. This may be an island snag, but we do have a nasty bomber coming up from here. And Lanalus has one lonely engineer left, but if he can peg these two, it's going to be a moot point, and neither guy is going to get the island. And that is about as good as you can ask for, because then Rock will inevitably get it as he is closer, and then full-blown eco advantage is owned by The Rock over the beach. This is a 6 mechs advantage. You've got 12 mechs on the beach slot, 13 mechs on the Rock slot, and then this is an additional 5 for whichever player gets it. Alrighty then. Early bomber harassment is real this time around. That is a lot of engineers that just bit the dust right there. That bomber got several passes, just about knocking out that mass extractor that's being upgraded. That would have been a brutal hit. And then the bomber from the southern side also picked off 4 engineers. Well done from M&B. Anytime you can lay down some harassment on the opposing front player, it is a good thing. That is going to let your front player get ahead and potentially steamroll the opponent. There was a nice little transport drop there. Unfortunately, the engineers did get down, and the damage from the falling transport was not enough to kill them. They're going to immediately start throwing down naval factories. And the reason you build these naval factories out here is so that you are closer to the opposing shore than if you build your factory way back here. That reduces the travel time of your frigates as you spam them out. We do have an answering jester, though. That is an excellent, excellent response from Foley. That thing is going to be able to pick off these 3 engineers quite easily, and then potentially even move down towards the south if he brings his interceptor cover with them. Jesters are speedy little boogers, and they don't go down very easily, sporting 525 health, which is huge for a T1 air unit. Look at that. 3 engineers dead overhead, a T1 anti-air turret, and it is going to get away. You don't find that much health on many T1 units at all. Up here on the northern side, we do have more bombers coming in from Laneless. This is key. I know I've said it a couple times already this cast, but helping your front player is critical on settings, because if you can get your front player ahead, they will usually return the favor with double navy in your water, one water or the other. And if you can eliminate an eco, that's a third of the threat gone from the map. Even if it is the front player, it's always helpful. And this is a little bit of a decision-making showcase, and we're going to have to find out which one of these guys wins. We have T1 Spam and Gun Commander versus T2 Commander with some extra build power. Granted, there are some T1 tanks in the back, but they are kind of lollygagging around in the rear, not doing a whole lot on the front lines. And that T2 point defense that was attempted right there was immediately shot down. And now we have Mantis streaming towards the base. That means that we're going to lose a mass extractor here, probably that one. And we do see land factories going down for that late to the game T1 spam that is so desperately needed to stop Mantis rush. Although that's not much of a rush, we can see production is pretty much ceased in the back here. Engineers going down, reclaim happening, and not a whole lot more factories going down. So I predict a stranding of Solar. He is going to be left out here with not enough units to back him up. We can already see there is an equal group of tanks coming forward from Philip J. Fry. And this is, good. Fall back, little man. Fall back. There is nothing to be done on the front lines. Yippee, little air battle. Not very pretty outcome for the Southern team. But it was an air battle after all, and the Jester is down. So I guess it's not a total loss. Tanks are going to move in and eliminate the Mantis threat. If the ACU was closer, that would be an easy mop-up for Cybern, because that additional damage from the Gun Commander would just mow down all those tanks. And here's what was planned. This is exactly what Solar had up his sleeve. Although this may backfire on him drastically. He built all those extra engineers to try to get Navy in the water and assist Foley. Because if you can win Navy early, you own the game for the rest of the match. This is a lost cause for M&B, but he has already got a naval factory down in the south. He's teching up a T3 mechs like a madman, trying to get an eco advantage over Laneless, even though he does have the island. But that is a losing battle. Anytime you try to tech versus rock, that is a losing proposition. Factory's going to go down, and that is the end of the proxy base. This is a whole lot more scary looking than it actually has in damage potential, because there are not enough units here to protect the ACU from this advancing horde, which means that Front is going to have to divert resources to stop this mess. And that means, yes, T2 Navy without a whole lot of frigate spamming. If these had all gone into full-blown frigate production mode, that would have been the end right there of M&B's Navy ambitions. There would have been no stopping that horde of frigates. But as it is, we do have Salems pushing out, trying to lay down some damage on these units. And Salems are very, very good at what they do. They have long reach, 80 range. They can stretch all the way across the neck to hit anything passing, which the UEF and Seraphim destroyers cannot do. And yeah, they do a decent amount of damage. So these guys are going to be able to lock down the neck. And T1 Kamikaze runs, not quite making it in with the bomb to kill that build power. If you can get about five Salems right here, that pretty much locks the entire neck down. You cannot get through, it will not work, and you will lose a lot of mass trying, and then any of these engineers can come in and scoop up the mass while the Salems defend. Pretty much a harassment game at this point, just trying to eat his way through, and it is pretty effective as you can see there. Walking on the land is not recommended though, because if you walk up on the land, that means that your maneuvering abilities have gone down drastically. You will not be very speedy, and this ACU can actually walk right up to you and overcharge your Salem. That is a lot of mass to go down the toilet in a hurry. Now, on the air is always critical to settings. We all know this, the air slot, you live and die by air. And looks like TA for Life at the moment is behind, but I will argue that TA for Life is probably going to blow Mr. White out of the water just looking at this point in the game, because his score may be 1K lower, but he has 30, count it, 30 more mass income and 1,000 more power income, which means that Mr. White's score is artificially inflated by the amount of ASF he has on the field. These T3 expensive air units are going to count a lot towards your score in the game. There we go, Thug for Life just passed him up. This eco, however, is reflective of how many ASF he will be able to produce later in the game. He's already got his T3 power generator down. He's already got three air factories going down. He's capping off all of his mexes, and he already has a T3. Whereas Mr. White, he does have all of them T2. He's about the same amount capping them, but he doesn't have a T3 P-Gen, and he does not have any T3 mech. So you can see where the eco situation is lying. These Salems are getting quite aggravating here. And I find it hilarious that the front player got out of Salem before the naval player did. He's already got two Salems and a cruiser, and here comes the first Salem from Foley. I'm going to get that name confused this entire game. You're going to have to bear with me. This looks like a T3 upgrade. I would have loved to see a torpedo upgrade. A torpedo upgrade with this many incoming frigates would be invaluable, but that may be T3. I think that's what that is. Don't quote me on it, but we'll just see in a minute if he starts throwing down harms. That will be a pretty good indicator. Mech's going down. Harassment was successful. That is a very, very tiny sliver of the eco shaved out from under Philip J. Fry. And these guys are going to hold position. Now, this is a tough call. There is so much build power down here and so many torp launchers. I don't think there are enough frigates at the moment to actually swarm this base, especially considering the fact that there is a Salem in the water now. There are three Salems in the water now, an additional Salem. So, yeah, frigates are not going to be the answer. If Solar were to pull his navy down, it might be a win, but it's looking kind of doubtful. MNB pulling 145 mass per tick, Foley pulling 182. That is kind of scary, although MNB is dipping into a little bit of reclaim. So M&B is putting down T3 mexes as fast and hard as he can. He's already got three of them down while building just enough navy to where he feels like he'll be safe against these guys. This is how you play it close to the chest in the beach slot. Beach, typically between two players of equal skill, Beach is going to lose to Rock because Rock inevitably has more eco. But the rule breaker on that one, and there is our first major air engagement of the game. It looks like Mr. White had it right off the bat. But TA for Life was able to scatter his ASF and then pull the loose group together around the backside of Mr. White's ASF. And that is going to be a complete and total air win for TA for Life. That is going to put him firmly atop the scoreboard with 138K to 109. And he is now outstripping Mr. White on Eco by, I was about to say 100, but it is not. I think that was a brief power stall for Mr. White, by around 40 mass per tick, if the eyes do not lie, and they may be. Let's take a look here. Not disrupted by reclaim. It looks like we got about 166 income, but that is a vicious power stall that he's got going on there. And power stall is the air player's worst enemy. TA for Life does have his two T3 power generators down for maximum adjacency, and that is going to help him out a ton. He's probably going to throw down two more P-Gens up there and run the rest of his ASF production off of the unassisted factories to maximize that adjacency. Let's get a quick destroyer count here. We've got five Salems plus two cruisers in the Green Navy, and it looks like Solar has lost his. And that is versus five, sixth incoming in 3, 2, 1. A greater Navy for M&B, and there's the harms that I was discussing earlier. So this is going to be a fairly easy win for him, especially thanks to the hover tanks coming in from Philip J. Fry. And this is going to be one ginormo gargantuan mass field to reclaim and run back home with to make some more shiny new ships to send out into the water. Hopefully they will do so quickly before the overbearing eco of two different players, and the one of them being the rock slot, comes to bear on poor old M&B. Looks like we've got fairly good things happening on the left-hand side. Laneless has got his T3 UEF factory down alongside his Aeon. This is something that I hope goes away very, very soon. Currently, you cannot win versus T... Excuse me. You can't win versus T3 Navy with any other faction. It just doesn't work. I'm sorry. There are a lot of people that have argued that any faction is viable, and I will agree with you that any faction is viable up to about 30 minutes. 30 minutes into the game, once the real ecos start rolling, if you do not have UEF battleships and the other player does, you will lose, strictly because of the alpha strike and range of the UEF battleship. And I am so thankful that that is getting tuned down in the next balance patch, because it was a long, long time coming. If you want to participate in the balance discussion, you need to head over to the forums. Because there is a lot of talking going on over there. There's a beta patch out, but the actual patch has not been released yet. All changes are on the table for discussion. Nothing is solidified yet. So it looks like we do have a T2 UEF factory right down here producing shield boats, and bulwarks are what's going to make the difference in this naval fight, because if you have an equal number of units, but you have one side that's short two destroyers and has two bulwarks, the extra health from the bulwarks will most likely let you win that naval engagement. But you know what? Numbers are not an issue at the moment. Yes, there's a lot of Salems, but M&B has a hell of a lot of naval units, a whole lot of hover tanks, and a couple of harms to back him up. In fact, he is so sure that he will be able to win this naval engagement for the next few minutes that he is going to throw down a Monkey Lord, which is kind of ridiculous even in my book, and I am such a troll in this game. This Monkey Lord is probably going to dive straight up the center of the map. He is building it off of the back of the reclaim that he's mopping up in the face of this oncoming army, which isn't doing a whole lot of oncoming. It's more like outgoing, because these suckers are dying in droves. Those bulwarks are helping out tremendously. And here's where M&B is showing off his masterful team playing skills. He is helping out on three sides of the map, three lanes. I'm anticipating a front launch for this Monkey Lord as soon as it's finished. He is holding back two players in his water, and he is donating torpedo bombers to the north side. And look at his eco, 148, and Foley is pulling in 225. Well, what is the enabler on this? M&B, 8,138 reclaim. Foley, 9,600 and change. But look at the mass in the water here. M&B is counting on picking up all of this. So it's kind of a gamble. It's a little bit of a gamble, I'm not going to lie. this, he is absolutely 100% counting on rolling the Navy back and reclaiming everything that he gets to make up where he has donated masks to other people. And I really hope that it works out for him, because if it does, he will have crippled the center lane. He will have helped out the northern lane a ton, and he will be in control of the southern lane. And you saw right there, some Salem started across in the mid here, and they were going to help out this Navy, but then, yeah, torpedo bombers circling. As soon as those Salems get in the water, they are dead meat. So they're going to come back on this side, I think partly because there was a slight advancement of these units. We've got engineers still cleaning up over here. That 9,000 reclaim, well, I was about to say they probably reclaimed over here, but it looks like Foley is slacking off a little bit. He is not getting out there to reclaim his stuff. Needs to be doing that. For that matter, where did the 9K reclaim come from? That is hard to determine. I guess from his initial starting point. Rock does get a lot of early mass. I mean, a lot of early mass. So that probably had something to do with it. All right, Monkey Lord is very nearly done. M&B pushing mass into that like a madman. We've got our first battle cruiser out, and it looks like Philip J. Fry is assisting with battleship production. That is where his eco's going. He's not building hover anymore, really. He's just dumping mass into a naval factory for M&B to get those units and use them as he sees fit, which honestly is not a bad idea. There goes a Salem. Thankfully, the Harms are still going to stay online, and those will slowly but surely eat away at the Cyber Navy to the north. Those Harms are brutal. Absolutely brutal. Such insane DPS on those guys, and the absolute swarms of torpedoes are pretty much unstoppable, even by navies with extremely good torpedo defense. So we got these torp bombers moving into the north. Those are going to be given over to Lanelis for micro, and that's actually the point I was going to make just a minute ago. A lot of times, the giving units to the player coordinating the main overall strategy is actually the better thing to do. I know it feels good to send in your own units and try to deal damage and say that you helped out the other player, but realistically speaking, especially if that person outranks you by 300, 400, 500 points, you should just build the unit and give it to them. There is such a thing as friendly fire in this game. It does not affect your own units for the most part, but firing through each other's units will only cause damage and stop DPS from hitting enemy targets. And then the coordination will never be as good with two players handling the units as it will with one player handling the units. So, in my personal opinion, whatever you may think of it, I really think that giving the units over to the other player completely is a good thing. So we've got this battlecruiser sitting here. It is going to trade blows with these Salems and do so quite effectively. Although hitting three different Salems with the damage that would be required to kill two, not so good because it left all three alive. But you can see the horrendous hull-tearing damage that comes out of that Neptune. This is why they trump T2 units so absolutely. They match range, they have fairly low HP, but you compare them with Bulwarks and it fixes that. And they do such an awesome job of mopping the floor with enemy destroyers. Although that is a terrifying amount of fire coming in. These guys are going to be moving into range of the Harms. That is going to be the end of them. Thankfully, all the Harms are picking different targets. A lot of times, these Harms act kind of stupidly because they will all target the same frigate, and then you end up wasting two-thirds of the DPS of your Harms. So many frigates! That Neptune has 5 kills now, still hitting away, but not making as much of a dent as it could have. Mostly due to the vast swarms. You don't want to get it too close, because if 7 or 8 destroyers come into firing range at the same time, like's about to happen, that battlecruiser is going to go down. 8 kills on the dial, shedding health rapidly. Don't think it's going to fare very well in this fight unless some shielding gets out to it. Gonna turn tail and run, dipping below 9,000 health right there. Killing a couple on the way out. Alright, out of firing range. It is safe for now. Let's check it out on the north. Lots and lots of battleships. 3, 4 battleships and 3 battle cruisers all sitting comfy beneath the protective layer of bulwarks and a hell of a lot of frigates. But there are many, many T2 subs picking away at the outside edges of this, applying decent continual damage to the shield layers. The only bad thing about this is the fact that these Neptune classes are not really engaging very well. There are battleships following up from the rear. They will be able to move in and do a lot of damage once they get in range, but this is a stalling point right here. Green can advance, but neither can Gray, because they don't have the right tools for the job. That is a frightening amount of battleships, though. Anytime you get that many battleships in one spot, you're going to have a bad time. Salem's ripping through this lower expansion here. MNB shedding mass extractor points. The UEF Navy is a fearsome thing, and having two battleships and a battle cruiser online, along with a Cybern battleship and almost a second one, that is bad news. However, there are already three battleships hanging out offshore for Foley, and we're getting a lot of eco lost here. A lot of eco going down the drain. Also in terms of reclaim, because he's not going to be able to reach back out and do anything at all. TA for Life is still firmly in control of air, and that is always your redemption in a sentence game, because as long as you have air, there's a chance. You can sneak in some bombers. You can throw some torps at them. You can do something, anything, as long as you have air. This is looking more and more depressing the more I look at it. This Monkey Lord may go on to do great things. I sincerely hope that it does. But the mass in that Monkey Lord, I think, is the mass that's missing to stop this onslaught. Oh my goodness. MNB, like I said, was counting on that reclaim, but here it is, unclaimed. There was enough Navy up here, especially with this Navy returning and not crossing the neck, to prevent any of that reclaim being taken. And now MNB is mass in the hole thanks to that Monkey Lord, and it's just waiting to die. Sitting there waiting to be destroyed. Lots and lots of frigates coming in. So many frigates, the bread and butter of the UEF Navy, but there's tons of T2 torps in the water. These Vespers will shred those frigates. Also, Neptunes. Neptunes should not be forgotten. I do love naval battles. They're so graceful. I also love how that Neptune is totally sailing backwards. Anyway, thanks to all the Neptunes and the subs, the frigate rush was easily handled, and this Navy is now going to have to start falling back. There is no way that it is going to hold against the superior mass dump of Lanalus. And you know, when it comes down to it, that's pretty much all there is to a naval battle. Yes, there's some micro, yes, there's some unit mixing, but basically it's the eco brought to bear, because the guy who has more ships, all things being equal, will win. Major air engagement. One thing that I'm noticing here is that TA for Life is doing a much better job overall of microing his ASF. Some of that is stop micro. Some of that is carefully chosen directions in multiple groups. You can see when large groups of fighters suddenly change direction, that is a direct command. And when they're lazily looping around each other or scattering, that is a stop order. And you use a combination of both. If your enemy clumps up and you can't get a good turn in, use the stop command. Your ASF will scatter everywhere. And then you can easily use move commands after that to regroup the cloud behind his ASF and hopefully come out ahead. It does take a bit of practice. It's not as simple as what I'm portraying, but it is extremely helpful. Monkey Lord moving up to the edge, not sure what he was hoping for there. I suppose he's trying to escape from the galaxy classes, but instead he ran directly into the summits. Not going to fare any better against summits than you are against galaxies, my friend. But he did wipe out the entire middle lane of eco before he died. There are two lonely mass extractors. Well, three. But the majority of the mechs are gone. And that was a decent amount of damage, even for having lost the Southern Navy. I think this loss of the Navy was inevitable. I really do. But still, I would have loved to have seen what that Monkey Lord worth of mass in frigates would have done to change the outcome of this bottom navy. So we have a T2 transport on the way from MNB. He does not even have resource allocation. This is going to be a tough game for him. Hopefully he will be able to do something. It looks like, yes, TA for Life was friendly enough to donate a T3 power generator, and that is going to keep him on his feet. Maybe a little bit of reclaim here and there, and he will actually be able to do something useful. He does already have that T3 ACU, and it looks like he's already built a freaking megalith. My goodness. See what his reclaim count is once again. We're up to 20,800, but I'm scared to look at Lane Alyssa's. 14,000. Wow. He's not gotten his engineers out to the front yet. That much is obvious, because there are thousands upon thousands upon thousands of mass in this water. If he can just get his mitts on it, he'll be able to pretty much build anything his heart desires. Let's take a look down the list here. TA for Life pulling in 17,000 reclaim. Mr. White, 9,000. Lanelis, as we mentioned just a minute ago, 16,000. He's already climbing up. 6,000 for Gareth, because Gareth has basically spent the entire game falling back. 9,000 for Foley. That would be this guy over here. MNB with 21,000, so exactly double Foley, near about. We've got 29,000 for Philip J. Fry, and Solar with 24,000. This Lanelis number is probably going to skyrocket momentarily, because he is going to be diving into all of this reclaim as he pushes this Navy back. Well, it didn't have any overhead in here anyway. Monkey Lords, you have no eco. Why are you building Monkey Lords? Well, he does, actually. He has some T3 mechs left over. Not all of them have died. There's a single Galaxy-class battleship tanking damage, keeping those mechs alive as long as possible. It looks like Philip J. Fry even gave him a couple mechs over here. If he can build these Monkey Lords and get them across the water over here, he could actually do irreparable damage to Gareth's home base. He is going to have to be careful, though, because Gareth does have the commander's shield. That means strat launch detected. That means that ACU will probably be able to walk right up and casually overcharge that Monkey Lord to death without really taking much damage in return. And that means mass donation, good folks. That nuke, I believe, is headed for right here. There's a nuke defense here that is not loaded, and will not be before it gets there. And there's a nuke defense here, which is loaded. And that worries me, because there's enough distance here that that build power could actually be wiped out. TA for Life pulling 481 mass per tick, a solid 100 lead over the opposing air player, and that is mostly thanks to the beauty known as resource allocation upgrade on the SACU. And it looks like we do have mass fabricators going down everywhere. The main loss in this is going to be build power. Here it comes, and boom, that was a lot of T3 power generators to lose. TA for Life is still making 27k, wow, that was a squeak, 27k power. But that is not going to be enough to power all these mass fabricators. That is a problem. He's going to have to shut those off. It looks like he does have the Eco Manager mod, which is doing it for him. So kudos to you, good sir, for having useful UI tools. More engineers being carried up to M&B. He's got his first Monkey Lord on the way, and the second is starting. Any minute now, though, he's not going to have enough Eco left to sustain that build, and he's going to have to start spreading engineers and reclaiming all of this yummy, yummy mass that is spread out before him like a buffet at Golden Corral. This is going to be one tasty little meal, and there might be a steak in there somewhere. Although you never know if it's a real steak. Might be dog for all you know. Who knows? Let's see here. TA for Life. Building power. Power everywhere. Power as far as the eye can see. He needs to ramp it back up very, very quickly. And also build power. That is what he needs. If he can get more build power online, I don't think that will actually make a dent, because he won air so hard the last couple of times that even without his production being online, he still has more ASF than Mr. White, and he's already proven that his micro is better, so I think this is going to be a win-win for him. The nuke hit a lot of power, yes. It slowed him down, yes, but he's still going to win it. There's a Megalith coming down the middle lane. That is going to be hard to stop. I don't see any direct counter that has been built. There's no Fat Boys, there's no Galactic Colossuses, there are no Strat Bombers, although Strat Bombers can be thrown up in a whole heap of a hurry. That Megalith is going to bear down on this ACU, more accurately, the Power Generator, because if you can kill the Power Generator, it's explosive damage dealt to everything next to it, and it also potentially takes down his shields. And there goes part of the shield anyway. Hammer the other, another large chunk of damage done to Gareth. And that is going to force his shields into a stall for sure. Mr. White calling for mass. Of course you need mass, buddy. You're building a Fat Boy. And he needs to do it quickly too. Monkey Lord coming in from Foley, but a Monkey Lord is in no way going to slow down a Megalith and a Monkey Lord put together. Megalith is now firing on the next Power Generator. It looks like that is going to be a total loss. Gareth accepting his fate, taking the Gentleman's Course and walking directly into the Monkey Lord to die. A glorious death in war. At least land some overcharges, bud. Don't go out without a bang. Yep, there we go. Overcharge landed, but it is not nearly enough when you also have Megalith bearing down on you. He is going to go up in smoke, and he has lost his T3 HQ already, so that is the last battleship that's going to roll off those assembly lines, and it is dead as a doornail. That means that we have a total naval victory in the north for the southern team, and a total naval victory in the south for the northern team, which is typically how it goes on Settings. This is how it works. You play musical chairs and end up occupying a seat slightly over, and the deciding factor in who wins the game is who still has a front slot and who is more quickly able to start shredding the territory of the other team through the naval slot. I have to say it does not look good for the southern team at the moment, because we have a Megalith right here. We have a Megalith right there. We have a Megalith right there. And we have multiple nuke subs coming down. So this just keeps looking worse and worse the whole time. But there's a Megalith. That's not good. Fat Boy is going to deal enough damage to this Megalith as he's pounding away at the Monkey Lord that Megalith is going to die to the Fat Boy. That is actually kind of surprising. Prioritize your targets, my friend. Hit that nuke defense, and that will help you out tremendously, because he does not have a nuke defense in the back. That is literally the only nuke defense in the center lane. If anybody has a nuke and that thing is gone, they can kill off Mr. White no problemo. Yeah, it looks like we got a GC coming up to answer this Megalith that is oh so slowly trundling towards that rock position. And a Fat Boy coming down for TA for life. A thug for life. I'm always going to get that name confused. What a lot of people don't realize is that the subs have tactical missile launchers that have extremely extended range. The range on these guys is huge. It's that yellow circle right there. You can use these to take out nuke defense, and I think these guys can actually reach this nuke defense right here. The damage that those missiles do is quite substantial, and I believe the Cybern tactical missiles actually feature the split that is traditional of all Cybern tacks, so that makes them very, very powerful. If you're able to snipe the nuke defense with one of these guys, then you're able to casually nuke from a safe distance, and they'll never know what hit them, because you can take out that nuke without a strat snipe, without anything obvious killing it. It's just 1 second it's there, next second it's dead, and then you're dead. MNB is going to make landfall. He's got a fresh Monkey Lord headed around the north side, and we're just going to have to see how well that does, because there is a T3 scout headed this way. Strategic I don't launch think they detect. Have eyes on it at this exact moment, but they will momentarily. There's the dead Megalith. Alright, where's that nuke headed for? Probably the island. Literally the worst thing that you can nuke right now, bud. There's an ACU right there, which is currently building TAC launchers in an effort to snipe something. There's a whole navy right there, which admittedly probably would not be a good target either, because, yeah. Summits can't reach that terribly far inland. I mean, they can reach long ways, but I don't know. Maybe it was the best target. Could have nuked this, but that doesn't take away Eco, and he's already won Navy. I don't know. Five T3 mechs and a whole bunch of fabricators. Why not? Although, he's only going to kill three. Not a perfectly placed nuke, but I suppose it will suffice. If you nuke in the exact right spot on the island, it is possible to kill all five mechs in one shot. I have seen it done multiple times, although I have never seriously tried to do it myself. Monkey Lord is going to make it into the North Base. I'm so amazed. Actually, no, I'm not amazed. There are no Aeon Air players, which means no mercies. So that means the Monkey Lord pretty much has free reign at the back end of the base. Mr. White's going to try to throw down some T3 point defense, but he's still assisting his nuke. If he would assist with his engineers, this might turn out differently. But as of right now, I think that Monkey Lord is going to kill that ACU. Because ACUs cannot run as fast as Monkey Lords. Possibly he will stop and go for the nuke itself. Yes, he will. And that may buy enough time, but I'm not 100% sure. All right, on the southern side, looks like we have not one, not two, but three Galactic Colossuses headed towards the south. And they will definitely be needed because we have another megalith rearing its ugly head out of the water, headed in to make landfall. That fat boy is going to be a tremendous asset when facing off against this long-ranged stuff. Strap bombers picking away at the health on that Monkey Lord. It is vetting off of all of the tasty goodness around it. And once again, setting off after the ACU, but I don't think that's going to be a successful play because there is a megalith coming in to defend the honor of Mr. White. He shall not be violated this day. Containment fields will hold and he will live to fight again. This fat boy, however, will most likely not, because it stumbled into the grasp of a megalith. And fat boys that get in range of a megalith, as you can see, go down in about a dozen firing cycles. So, yeah. Not a good plan there, bud. Not a good plan. These attack launchers took some damage from the fat boy that was coming in, but that fat boy is now down, and we have engineers biting into the hulking wrecks of megaliths, fat boys, whatever else they can get their hands on. Let's take a look at these reclaim numbers once again. TA for life pulling in 19,000, about the same as when we looked a little while ago. 145,000 and rising like all get out for Laneless. Laneless wins the reclaim award. Woo! He is pushing out 965 mass per tick in expenditures, and he is still 200 mass per tick plus
strategic launch detected.
Overhead income. That is ridiculous. Mr. White pulling in 9,500. Foley with 40,000. Garrus dead. Pulled in 16,000 before his death. Solar with 109. Mostly thanks to down here, and that is what he's using to pull. Oh my word. That is exactly what happened, folks. The TML and the megalith. Possibly a couple shots from the megalith. I do apologize for not saying it. Actually, that was probably the megalith because we have collateral damage. Let's say the megalith. The megalith was able to take out the nuke defense, and the strat subs were able to fire directly behind this nuke defense and take out the airbase. That is a brutal strike. Not enough to be game deciding, but it hurts. Ooh, pretty salvation. Maybe we'll get to see one of these this game. Anyway, Solar has no base, and he is still churning out megaliths because reclaim. Reclaim, reclaim. M&B also ticking in with 52,000 reclaim, a respectable number. 120 now for Solar. And Philip J. Fry, 49,000 mass reclaimed. There is so much reclaim going on. This is absolutely mind-boggling. Laneless is about to clear 200,000 reclaim. There is a freaking Skathis started, for crying out loud. You have no mechs, and you'll start Skathis. Are you daft? Actually, he was, because he abandoned the Skathis, but other people can feel free to monopolize on his investment. That was an incorrect use of the term, but whatever. I think you guys knew what I meant. Salem's moving in. Unfortunately, no match for the range of a fat boy. I don't think that five Salems even have the firepower to break down the shield of the fat boy if the fat boy is firing at them the entire time. However, if the fat boy is wasting all of his firepower on these mobile flaks in the background, that is an entirely different story, and those Salems have a reasonably good chance. We'll just have to see if that fat boy is able to recover its targeting priorities before it gets taken down. Still one nuke loaded in that. TA for life is going to have to get the hell out of Dodge before too very much longer. Once these strat subs start pouring out their nukes, it starts to get a little bit hairy. Looks like we've got four so far. Yes, four. That is a nuke once every minute and 15 seconds if they're on exactly opposed firing cycles, which means you will need roughly four nukes, nuke defenses lightly assisted to 100% for sure clear them out. I don't think they have scouted this yet. Let us take a look. No, they have not. Hasn't been a scout over that in a long, long time. And that means they have no idea that there's a half-completed salvation down there, which means that they're not going to be focusing their nukes on it. So TA for life, even if your only function in this life is a meat shield, I think you will have served your purpose. I love Torrents. I love seeing Torrents being used. Torrent is such an appropriate name. Look at the amount of firepower cascading down upon this base. That is only a handful of Torrents. Let's see, that is six, seven, yes, seven Torrents. Shift G command is your friend. All you have to do is grab the torrents, click over some targets, and press Shift G. And yeah, they'll all hit individual targets and it will be mayhem. Here comes another nuke. There are two loaded in the defense now, but bear in mind that two nuke defense, even if assisted a little bit, are not going to be able to keep up with four strat subs, as we're seeing here. There goes the last nuke that's loaded in that. We got another half loaded there. And almost one loaded right there. When this one launches, there will be... But that's all, folks. There will not be a nuke defense in the chamber. So that's going to cause some major, major issues. And there is the salvation. That is about to start unleashing its fury at the other side of the map. And this is where you pair a salvation with a couple of nukes. As long as you can build enough nuke defense and T4s to protect this thing, you are golden. Kaboom, kaboom. And away they go. Probably targeted at some nuke defense on this side. All you have to do is pick off all of the nuke defense and then nuke them to death. That is what you use a salvation for. Actually, I've seen salvations misused a lot of times. They try to pick off things salvation is good at. Killing build power, killing power grids, and killing nuke defense. Things the salvation is bad at. Killing single targets, killing factories, that kind of thing. If you aim at those, you're going to end up losing even though you have a salvation because the other people can outproduce you. But if you take out nuke defense and then proceed to systematically nuke all of their build power and economy, well, then you're going to win. All right. Man, that is a mistake right there, concentrating all of your nuke defense in one spot. When you lose one, you're going to lose all of them, especially if you kill the power generator sitting right in the middle. Not very smart placement on that one. So many ASF clearing out all of, well, what's left of Mr. White's Air Force. Luckily, he did save his strat bombers. But there are no more ASF to be had. That group did have to fly over a lot of flak, but even though they're all in varying degrees of damage, I don't think it's going to matter that much. Fatboy moved a little bit too far forward, unfortunately. He is going to die to all that battleship fire. Kaboom, kaboom. things are literally made of paper. I don't know if you knew that, but... Commander trying to move up. I don't know if you knew that, but these are actually origami folded constructs with shield generators inside to keep them expanded. That is exactly what Fat Boys are. Ooh, attack launch. Where was that going? I did not see. I don't think it succeeded. Possibly at a nuke, and I was looking at it the wrong way, or that was a graphical glitch.
Strategic launch detected.
Alrighty then, here comes the nuke. And oh no, he retargeted. He retargeted the Salvation, assuming that the shots in the air. Ah, SACU death. I was wondering what the nuke sound was. He assumed the shots in the air would kill that nuke defense, and the nuke defense survived with 280 health, and it is loaded. And he can't retarget the Salvation that fast. So that nuke is going to get shot down. That would have been such a beautiful nuke, too. It was right in the middle of all that power grid. That would have been like 6 T3 power generators gone offline. And at this point in the game, power is actually more critical than mass is. Because look at all the reclaim. You can reclaim however much mass you want. It doesn't matter. It can be done. On the other hand, power is a finite resource, which only comes from these buildings. And so if you lose all of these buildings, you are screwed.
Strategic launch detected.
Here comes more Salvation fire. That's the graphics glitch I was talking about. You see that shot right there? Whee! Way out to the side. Sometimes when you're scrolling in and out and artillery shots are on the screen, they do all kinds of weird things, or attack launchers or whatever. Strats everywhere, and not a single ASF to be seen. Now, what remains to be observed is whether or not TA for Life has the wits about him to get his ASF down from the corner, because the further these strat bombers come south, the more I'm worried that something bad is going to happen. At the moment, the southern team has won the game. Like, there's no doubt about it. Although there are two megaliths. What? What? Why? What is this madness? The strat bombers were pinged, by the way, and TA for Life is flying in the exact opposite direction. This is turning into a strategic facepalm. What is this? There comes the nuke. That's going to connect. I like that. What I don't like is literally 25 plus SACUs running from two megaliths, and they have a GC right there. Like, what the crap is that? That could easily slaughter a megalith. That could actually reclaim a megalith to death. They're engineering units, and the megaliths have since split up. So these guys are retreating for no apparent reason. There goes the nuke. That's Salvation trying to clean up. Here come the strat bombers, TA for Life's. ASF are still way over here. What is this? What is happening to this game? It was all so beautiful, and now it's going off the rails. It was a lot of SACUs nuked right there. Here come the strats, and... no more nuke defense. That one is not loaded. It just finished building. This one is loaded. And here comes the traditional sentence rage. I hope all you guys were waiting for this.
Strategic launch detected.
Although, in this one instance, just this once, I'm actually going to say that it's justified. Because TA for Life has literal, complete, total air control. There is not a single ASF anywhere on the field from the other team. He has about 100 at his disposal, and strap bombers that were pinged got through. This is why you pay attention, folks. You don't go on autopilot when you think the game is won. Here come the strats again. They're actually going to get another pass. TA for Life just put his ASF on patrol on the north side. There go the strats. Power generator taking critical damage. The nuke defense is down, and it had nearly loaded a second shot. That means that there is absolutely no way on earth that that nuke defense is going to get loaded. One more nuke and these guys are done for. I can't believe that. I can't believe it. They... Oh, my word. This has got to go up as a strategic facepalm, because I had never... Okay, I have.
Strategic launch detected.
At this rank level, I have never seen a game thrown away to this extent. I mean, no offense personally to TA for Life. Who knows? He may have been drunk or high or half asleep or whatever. Everybody screws up. But that was just...
Strategic launch detected.
Good lord. That was awful. I gotta say, I observed earlier, people were raging at Solar because he basically left Megaliths sitting here that could have been doing other things. And I can say from personal experience that Solar is usually high when he's playing, so he doesn't tend to listen to things that people say. I wasn't too terribly concerned about that, but TA for Life usually does better than that. And now, that is GG. Like, the southern side really doesn't have anything left. The air production is gone. They have a few ASF, but now Mr. Smith has his production back online. So, yeah, that's not going to do him much good because he's quickly going to outstrip any ASF that the southern team can build. He's got all these strat bombers online, and they basically own the south side. Yes, there's 3 GCs online, but 3 GCs can't be everywhere at once. Not to mention all of the nuke subs, which are continually reloading. Such a terrible weapon. Although I do love them. I can't lie. I love nuke subs. They're one of my favorite things. Someone should remake Mary Poppins' list of... Or no, hold on. That's not Mary Poppins. It's the right person! The wrong movie! Someone should remake Julie Andrews. I am so ashamed. Someone should remake Julie Andrews' few of my favorite things about SUPCOM. I think that could be a hysterical song. I may have to sit down and write one. Believe it or not, I've actually written a couple of parodies for SUPCOM. I just never get around to actually putting them out. Mostly because I can't really produce my own music very well. Do not have such equipment. Alright, basically I'm just killing time, watching random things happen on the map, hoping that this madness will end soon, because... Two strats killing his base while ASF are sitting there. Lanel is commenting. I think TA for Life has basically gone AFK at this point. Not a whole lot left to stick around for, honestly. The North is rebuilding. And now we wait for KOs. This is one of the worst parts, because in extended games like this, you know when one team's won. You just know. But a lot of times it actually takes quite a bit of time for the real ending to come about.
Strategic launch detected.
Because everybody's kind of just waiting for the lethal blow to come in. Now, when there's that many nuke launchers hovering around in the water, your end may be swift and brutal and unanticipated, but you're still waiting on the end. So the nuke was headed right here. We do have a nuke defense loaded. Two nuke defense loaded. Wow. Lanelis is being a pain. Saying I'm not going to die because of a stupid teammate. I am just going to sit here and survive as long as I possibly can to be a stick in the butt of everyone else who is playing with me. He is AFK. I guessed as much. Alrighty then. I guess I'll just ramble for a few. So, cool news about the channel. I'm actually getting out of my network. I will no longer be part of a network as of August 15th, which means that I no longer have any stipulations to generate ad revenue or to do anything else for that matter. I have no legal obligations after this point. So, I am debating on going ad-free. I know a lot of you guys use ad blocker anyway, which, you know, I don't make my livelihood off of YouTube. I wouldn't turn it down, but realistically speaking, there's no way to make a living off of casting Supreme Commander, and the YouTube market is flooded anyway. But, as I've said before, this pays my electric and internet bills, which I'm very, very, very thankful for. You guys have been awesomely generous as far as that goes. Strap bombers everywhere. I was trying to rebuild the Salvation,
strategic
too.
Launch
I mean,
detected.
Kudos to him for trying, but realistically speaking, at this point, there's really nothing he can do. Because air is just awful. Anyway, okay, so I'm not technically allowed to say how much that ad revenue YouTube generates, but I can say that I can turn off ads if people pledge like $25 on Patreon and I won't be taking any losses. So there you go. There's my roundabout Weasley information on that. But anyway, that would keep it up where, you know, everything's paid for and I can do this. It's an awesome hobby. I love to do it. I do it anyway. But, you know, if people see fit, if you're a running ad blocker and want to contribute a little bit, the Patreon account is there and I also have a PayPal down there. And you guys know that I typically don't ask for this kind of stuff. It's a once every couple of months thing, but there it is. All right, hopefully you enjoyed that game. Everybody had been asking for sentence, and there is a sentence for you, long and drawn out as they always are, and hopefully you learned a couple things from it and saw a couple tactics that you can recycle, reuse, and kill people with. That is the point after all, isn't it? Anyway, I am done and out of here. Thank you as always for watching. Please send me replays if you have any good games, and I will see you guys in the next cast on Thursday.